Hello everyone, my name is George Mihaiescu. I'm a cloud architect with Ontario Institute for Cancer Research. Okay, better? Okay. So my name is George Mihaiescu, I'm a cloud architect with YCR, and I'm going to cover today how you can work in open source cloud environments like OpenStack, and especially in Cancer Genome Collaboratory, which is a cloud computing environment built especially for cancer research. So it's customized for this purpose. We will cover a little bit about the computing technology evolution, some difference between classic high-performance computing environments versus the new cloud technologies. I'm going to cover OpenStack and its components, similarities with other public cloud solutions like Amazon and Google Cloud and Microsoft Azure. Then I'm going to cover the project's goal and history, the Cancer Genome Collaboratory project. And I'll also cover Docker containers and differences versus virtual machines. So, computing evolution. A few years ago, it used to take months or weeks for a developer to, or any compute user to, have a new server ready for a project. They had to be ordered, delivered, had to be installed, racked. The IT team had to install the operating system, networking team had to connect the cable, security team had to hard secure it, and it was a very time-consuming process. With virtualization, this process was reduced to maybe weeks or days, depending how fast the IT team was moving, but still it was not as agile as developers and users wanted to have it. And then cloud came, and somebody with a credit card could just create an account on Amazon and have a server up and running in mere minutes. So very, very fast. But still was not good enough. Container technology was made popular, and that means that starting a Docker container with application running is reduced to only seconds. So even faster provisioning time, as well as lower overhead versus a virtual machine. And as the technology progresses, now Lambda functions or serverless is a new technology where you don't even have a container or a virtual machine up and running and waiting for requests. You just upload your Lambda functions and the cloud provider executes those functions when the user sends a request. So you pay just for the CPU cycle used by your function and the time it took to execute. Okay. So for example, if you have, let's say, a web server, instead of having a web server running 24/7 for maybe 5 requests a day, okay, you can have the request being served only when they come, and you only pay for that, the time it takes to execute those queries. Characteristics of high-performance computing, which probably most of you are used to use in your organization's environment. Basically, they are shared. They are very fast most of the time, depending on when they were deployed. They have a fixed configuration, meaning that they have the same operating system. They have the same CPU type, usually the same networking. Usually, they also have shared storage, so if the files are uploaded to the main node, they are available to all the compute nodes where your code is getting executed. But you also do not have root access on the worker nodes. Usually there are no containers allowed because it's not a very secure technology. And usually there is no access from the internet without going through the IT team, and they have to open up the firewall to allow the traffic. Which usually they don't want to do that. You also don't have a choice of the kernel version, libraries versions, operating system, and most of the time there is no cost recovery to the end users. So The end user sometimes leave their files sitting around because they don't pay for the storage. They leave maybe jobs working running for a long time because they don't pay for the CPU usage. So can be necessarily very efficient. In cloud computing, on the other hand, it's shared in the sense that there is a pool of hardware servers, of hardware gear that is shared between the users of the cloud environment, different projects, different users. It is flexible. The cloud provider can reconfigure the servers. And there is usually no shared storage. Shared storage means that if the shared storage is broken, everything is broken. Okay? In cloud computing, the idea is to have a very scalable architecture where there are no single points of failures. If you have a hardware failure, it's going to impact a very limited part of the cloud. It's not going to be taken down everything. The users have root access in the virtual machines that they start, that they launch. They can also install Docker containers inside those virtual machines. They can choose whatever kernel version they want, whatever operating system version they want. So if they want to use CentOS or Debian or Ubuntu or anything else, they can do it. They can also control access to the virtual machines. So if they want to serve a web server on port 9000, they do that, open up the firewall. Okay, so it's a shared responsibility model where the cloud provider takes care of the APIs, protects them, and protects users from attacking each other, and protects the infrastructure. But the users are responsible for protecting the virtual machines that they launch. Okay? So it's a shared responsibility model. And has a small failure domain, as I said. It's built with commodity hardware, which is cheap, but you can get a lot of it. So if you have a failure, which is unavoidable at scale, that failure is going to impact just the workloads that were running there, okay, which will be just a few instead of impacting everybody. And there is cost recovery. So users are impacted by their actions, and they have to be conscious about the resources they use, clean up after themselves, and shut down or terminate instances that are not longer in use, delete the files. Some of the, probably you heard of the, this very well-known cloud technology providers like Amazon Web Services, which is the largest in the world right now. They started 8-9 years ago. Then Google, the second place probably with Microsoft Azure. But on the private side of the cloud technology, there are a few projects that offered open source versions of cloud computing. CloudStack, OpenNebula, OpenStack. OpenStack seems to be now the main leader in open source public and private cloud computing. So if you want to deploy cloud computing and you don't want to go and pay Amazon or Microsoft or AWS, you want to do it yourself, OpenStack is the main choice you have without having to pay anything. Some of the very large users that are publicly using OpenStack for their environments, AT&T, Verizon, Comcast. Some of them are like Walmart, Best Buy. They decided to build their own cloud computing environments because they didn't want to pay their competitor. So Amazon basically competes with Best Buy and competes with Walmart, so they didn't want to give them IT dollars, okay? And Amazon basically to compete with them. So plus, they have much more flexibility in building their own environments. They have the freedom to innovate, and they cut their costs with external IT providers.
Is OpenStack free?
Yes. Yeah. So there is no cost. Of course, you can buy OpenStack support from companies that offer, like Red Hat, Canonical, IBM. But like we did it, you can deploy it yourself. You download the software, install it, and if you want to change it, you have access to the open source. It's written in Python. You can customize it, so it's a very viable alternative to going and paying an external provider. And OpenStack is used heavily in research. So CERN, the Physics Institute in Switzerland, has 190,000 cores using OpenStack, and in the next 6 months, they are deploying another 100,000 cores. So very, very large environments that use OpenStack. DKEB, that the researchers in Germany is an OpenStack user, they have a large cluster. EBI in London, OpenStack user. ETRI in Korea, YCR has two large OpenStack clusters. Many others who are, they decided to use OpenStack for their research environments. Most of them in parallel with HPC, so HPC is still a viable alternative. Okay? But as users demand more freedom in having root access and using other type of operating systems, and they decided to offer a cloud environment with self-service and cost recovery sometimes, depends how it's deployed. So you will probably in your careers, as you get to work in different places, chances that you'll find an OpenStack cloud environment pretty high. So it's a good technology to learn. And as you will see in the lab, it's not very different than Amazon or Google. The concepts are the same. What is different is, of course, the user interface and the command line. Okay? But it's not very different in terms of concept. I'm going to cover a little bit about OpenStack. Again, as I said, it's a free and open software platform. It was developed initially by NASA and Rackspace. In 2010, NASA was developing a solution for storing their large image library. And Rackspace, which is a cloud, is a data center provider, was back then in the US, was developing a technology to start virtual machines, to orchestrate them, self-service for the users. So they met and they said, okay, we have this project, which we are working, we have progressed already doing this, and you have the other one, we want what you have, you want what we have, so let's make an open source project and put the code together. And then, because it's written in Python, it was very easy for a lot of other developers to join the project and to start committing code. And it has a release cycle of 6 months, which means that every 6 months there will be changes. It's a bit hard for the end users to upgrade because once you have it in production, upgrading it can be difficult. So if you are not upgrading, on the other hand, you'll be 6 months, a year and a half farther from the current version, so even harder. So it's not easy for the IT teams to actually deploy it and make it work, but the alternative is to basically send the IT budgets directly to Amazon and do not have any IT in-house. And if Amazon decides to increase the prices or do things differently, you are basically at their mercy. So it's a very interesting technology for an IT department to work with. It's challenging, but it's very interesting because you can look behind the scenes, see how it is built. You can see its inner workings and can make changes. It's fun to work with. It started with just a few projects, providing virtual machines, which is called compute, basically, networking. Like a virtual private cloud in Amazon where you can have your own networks with IP addresses and everything else, block storage, and so on. Now there are more than 19 projects that OpenStack has trying to mimic what Amazon and the other public cloud providers offer. So Amazon has probably 100 services from everything as a service, basically. OpenStack is not that advanced, but has the core services that allow other developers and other companies to come and to add new platform as a service offerings. As I said, it's a complex distributed system. This is a diagram, which is a simple diagram with just a few services showing how the user can access the cloud environment through the internet and can either hit the dashboard, which is a portal similar to AWS console, and use the browser to launch virtual machines, create networks, do everything they have to do. But they can also talk directly to the APIs that the portal talks to when executes user requests. So you can have an OpenStack client with credentials set, and you can start VMs without having to use a browser ever. Okay? And you can also, yes?
Can you define
API? API is basically, in the case of OpenStack, is a web service, okay, that receives RESTful calls like GET, POST requests, and translates those HTTP requests into actions that happen in the back end. Yes. Yeah, and it allows, once you basically have this API, you can, the end user can build other applications that you can have your own dashboard. You can have a web server that has different pictures and different buttons and different, okay? When you click on them, they make a GET request to this address with this content, okay? So that's why all the companies now say, hey, we provide open APIs, or we give you access to our APIs. It means that they let the end user to innovate even more. Like Twitter has an API, and that allows end users to get in bulk tweets without having to scroll to all the tweet feed, okay? You can make an API call, give me 100,000 tweets that have this keyword, and get back a very large chunk of JSON that you can then filter and create a report and so on. So that's the benefit of APIs. It allows more innovation than the company who has the API can. They want to create an ecosystem. They want to basically get more features from the end users, involving them into the development of new features. OpenStack services have a similar structure. Yes? I'm not sure I heard exactly the question.
So I'm trying to understand how does OpenStack, what's OpenStack's business model? Because like they also need like all these servers and...
OpenStack is not a business. It's an open source foundation. So they don't have a business model. There are companies who offer OpenStack-based services, like Red Hat, for example, has an OpenStack distribution where you can go and buy support from them, and they will install it for you, and you use it, and if you have a problem, you call them, and they fix it for you.
But I guess he's asking, like, then why do they get into all this trouble of, like, hiring people, paying them to create all this, if everything was for free? And probably, I guess you pay afterwards, right? When you create your own, like, instance and stuff, and you have to analyze data, you pay someone. Like,
yes.
That's where they
end user pays,
yeah.
Exactly. Yes, but the cost is the software itself. So for a research institute, when they want to deploy OpenStack, they don't pay anything. They go and buy the hardware, they install Ubuntu, they install OpenStack, and then they start using it. If they want to charge their local users for the resources that they use, they can do it. If they don't, because they have another model of financing the IT department through grants or otherwise, then they don't. But OpenStack is not a software that you have to pay for. It's not like Microsoft Office or others, like Salesforce or software that is pay per pay. And this is the OpenStack dashboard. It's a very simple reference implementation of a portal that comes with OpenStack and is used by most users of OpenStack. But as I said, companies who build, like Rackspace has a cloud environment where they offer virtual machines and other services like Amazon, is based on OpenStack, their portal looks different because they customize it. Okay? But if you install OpenStack, you can install their base implementation and you have a portal ready to go. Easy to work with. Sure, if you want to have it more complex and do more things, you have to do it yourself, but it comes with a ready-to-use dashboard. OpenStack Cinder is the project that offers the end users block block volume. So basically, if you are familiar with the Elastic Block Service in Amazon, where you can create a volume, attach it to an instance, and have more space for that virtual machine. And if the virtual machine dies, the data that you are storing on the volume survives, is permanent, is the same concept. In OpenStack, in a virtual machine, you want it to have more space, you create a volume of 100 gigabytes, you attach it to your virtual machine, you log in, you see that it has a raw disk attached, dev SDB. You can format it, partition whatever, mount it, and you start using it. You put your data there. Tomorrow something happens with the server where the virtual machine was running, you lost your virtual machine. The data that you have on the volume survives. Create another virtual machine, attach the same volume. This time you don't have to format it and mount it or anything else because it has a file system with your data on it. You are good to go. OpenStack Neutron is the project that offers software-defined networking, allowing you to create complex networking scenarios. There are plugins for many commercial networking vendors like Cisco, Juniper. All the vendors decided to provide a plugin that allows their devices to be controlled by OpenStack. Why? Because Amazon and Google and Microsoft, they are not going and buying hardware from Dell and from IBM and from HP. They go directly to factories in Asia and they are building custom servers. The same way they don't go to Cisco and Juniper and Brocade and all the other networking vendors to buy switches and routers and firewalls. They go to Asia and they build custom. So all these manufacturers decided to get involved in OpenStack in order to give the companies an option to build their own cloud environments while still buying hardware from them. So Best Buy basically now can still go to Dell and buy servers and install OpenStack and control the servers easily with OpenStack and still can go to their vendor Cisco and buy switches and control them with OpenStack. So the entire industry basically rallied trying to offer a free software solution for building cloud environments. So not all the IT budgets go to the 3-4 public cloud providers. And this also gives a negotiating tool for end users. Still, they go to AWS, but they also have an in-house environment. They can go to AWS only when they have to burst, like Best Buy has a sales day, like Black Friday, and their capacity in-house is not enough to serve all the traffic. They have servers in Amazon, but that's just for a few days. Most of the year, they serve the traffic from the in-house environment. And the same with Walmart and everybody else. If they didn't have this, they would have to pay all year long to the public cloud providers. And the same with research organizations. If they have a request to do an analysis, they don't have enough capacity, sure, they can go to Amazon and pay as you go. And it's a very good solution if you have the money and it's a one time. But what if you have to do this more and more often? Sometimes, you know, one day you'll say, it's better to actually, let's do this ourselves, so we don't have to pay so much every time, because it's cheap if you look at 1 hour, but if you multiply by 24 hours, 365 days, the cost for a server is many more times that it costs you to do it yourself. So as I said, cloud has extended functionality, like software-defined networking, block storage, object storage, like Dropbox and Google Drive, where you can upload your files and download them as over HTTPS. Cloud Unity is an invention, I guess, of AWS, because they started the entire cloud computing revolution, and is a software package that comes pre-installed on most Linux distributions. So what it does is, when the virtual machine starts for the first time, okay, it resizes the file system of the virtual machine to use the entire space of the disk that the virtual machine has. So the VM could have a disk of 20 gigs, but the image that it starts from could be very small, like 200 megabytes. So when the user logs in for the first time, he's going to see a disk of 20 gigabytes already, okay? Even though the image that he used to start that virtual machine from was very small. So this happens before the user logs in for the first time. Also, the CloudInit package is downloads the SSH key that the user chose when he started the virtual machine and injects it in the authorized files of that user in the file system. So when the user SSHs, he is allowed to log in. Can also download the file that the user provides and execute it. And we'll see this later in the lab, where you can basically create a script with instructions of what should happen. And when you launch the instance, the virtual machine, you give it this script. And even you don't even have to log into the virtual machine, because the virtual machine starts, downloads that script, executes it, which could be a number of steps, like downloads this file, runs this analysis, uploads its results. So it lets you basically do a hands-off execution without having to SSH and to do this manually on each server. And that link provides more information about how you can use it, what it can do. It's a very powerful tool and is available in Amazon and in Google and in OpenStack, of course. Cancer Genome Collaboratory, so I'm going to go now into the part where we discuss about this environment, which I design and currently manage at the YCR. And the project goal, its history, progress, and current capacity. Is a cloud computing environment built for biomedical research by Ontario Institute for Cancer Research. It was based on a four-year grant awarded to build this large-scale cloud infrastructure in order to store the data sets generated by the International Cancer Genome Consortium. It had multiple cores. Core 1 was building the infrastructure, core 2 was research, core 3 was outreach, so multiple cores. I'm working on the core 1, which is building the infrastructure. And the goal was to have 3,000 cores of compute capacity and 15 petabytes of storage. And we decided to build it with open source, so we use the money from the grant for capacity and not for paying licensing licenses and software and support and so on. And we built it with OpenStack for the cloud orchestration, and we built it with Ceph, which is another open source software for storing very large data sets. Before I started working on Collaboratory, I had about 6 months where I was part of a group that was doing BAM alignment and later VCF calling. So even though my training is in IT, not in bioinformatics, I managed a few cloud environments, some of them public cloud and some of them based on OpenStack. So I saw during the analysis how the resources were used and the type of workflows and the type of workload that are used in cancer research. So then when I started the design, I knew how to design it based on this type of analysis. So in whole genome sequencing, at least, users download the very large files. We had the largest one was 800 gigabytes. Tumor file with very high coverage. But most of them are between 150 to 300 gigabytes. And you need two files, at least, a normal and a tumor, or multiple tumors, depending. And the workflows, if it was a BWMM alignment, could take 7 days, depending on how many cores the VM had, how much memory, disk access. And the data generated after alignment, it's the same as big as the input data, usually a little bit larger, but let's consider it the same. So you generate very large data sets as well. For VCF calling, the data sets generated are much smaller, 5-10 gigabytes, just the mutations. based on our experience working in public cloud providers like Amazon and OpenStack-based like research environments, it's better to design the workflow so it's small, it's modular, and if you have a failure, it only impacts one analysis. Okay? We had in Amazon where we had four VMs running in a cluster, and after 4 days, 80% done, the workflow would crash, lose everything. You lost 4 days of very large VMs doing compute. Everything is gone. If we had split this in individual, it would take probably 10 days for each to finish. But if you lose one after so many days, you only lost one. So smaller failure domains. Also, we decided at the end to package the workflows as Docker containers. And this allowed us to have reproducible workflows. So we run a Docker container in DKZ, or we run it in Amazon, or we run it in ETRI. It was running the same, even if the OpenStack or the VMs was Ubuntu versus Red Hat or different versions. So containerized applications in container helps a lot with portability and reproducibility. Since the CPU usage of the I think the VCF calling, you can see, maybe you cannot see it there, but it's like 12 days usage. So the blue line shows the CPU usage. At the beginning of the workflow, you can see CPU a little bit, okay, and then the first phase is 100%, and then probably some merging, happening, and then again dropping, but out of the 12 days, probably 80% of the time CPU was saturated. That also means that you cannot oversubscribe resources in a cloud computing designed for cancer research because of the workloads. If we were to run like web servers that use 10% of the CPU, on a one physical core of the server, you can run 10 VMs with one core because each VM just uses 10% most of the time. So you run 10 of them, you get 100% utilization. In a cloud computing build for cancer research, if you have a server that has 40 cores, you can only provision VMs that use probably 38 cores. Okay? You leave 2 cores for the server itself and 38 cores. If those VMs do something like this, they will saturate the CPUs that is provided to them. So oversubscription is out of the question for cancer research. Other workloads, like most of the web workloads, they are good with oversubscription. Some people do it at 16 to 1. Like you have one physical core, you provide 16 virtual cores because they are not using, they are using a very little bit of the CPU most of the time, but not in cancer research. Memory usage, this VM had 48 gigs of RAM. As you can see, most of the time it used probably 16 gigs, but there are steps in the workflow where it used up to half. That means that, again, you cannot oversubscribe memory because there are steps in the workflow that will fail if you don't give it enough memory. So another good lesson, do not oversubscribe memory either. Disk I/O usage shows that at the beginning of the workflow, the disk is saturated because it has to download the data, and there is a write of write activity to the disks. Okay, but after that, and also in the merging phases, a lot of disk activity. After that, there is very little bit, very little I/O activity, reading and writing from the disk. That means that if you schedule your workflows with a little bit of delay in between, they will not hit the same step where they download and write in the same time. Okay? So you can have like a half an hour spread. So the physical disks that have to execute the reading and writing requests from the virtual machines will basically do a much better job if they don't have to do it in the same time for everybody. And this space usage, we saw that this is the available disk free disk space, so it drops at the beginning when the data is injected, is downloaded from the repository, After that, there's another drop when there are some temporary files created, which are then deleted, and free space goes up again. Okay. So by monitoring what happens with the virtual machines during the workflows allowed us to decide when we are going to build it, what to focus on, and how to do it. Collaboratory data, if you are familiar with the ICGC data portal, it's the dcc.icgc.org. It's built by the bioinformatics team of which I'm a part of. My colleagues did a great job. They also index nightly the data stored in Amazon, in Collaboratory, in other repositories. So you can go to the DCC portal, you can filter and query the data that you are interested in, and you can generate a manifest file containing the object IDs of the files that you want to work with. And then you can, we'll see later, use that manifest file into your client and download all the files and use them. Okay. We built this custom object storage that, developed at YCR. It uses the S3 API because we store most of the dataset from ICGC in Amazon and in Collaboratory. So we wanted to do the work only once, so we built a client. Because Collaboratory, the object storage in Collaboratory is S3 compliant, so the object store from Amazon is similar to the one in Collaboratory, we are able to use the same client against both providers, Collaboratory and Amazon. It has some very interesting features where it can resume downloads and uploads. So if you download a file that's 100 gigs and halfway through your VM crashes or something happens, networking drops, you can restart or resume the download without having to download 50 gigs again. It sees where it left and continues from there. It also does BAM slicing. You can tell your client, I don't want to download this entire whole genome. I want to download just, give me a slice from chromosome 20 from this position to this position, okay? And because the client talks to the metadata server behind the scenes, the metadata server knows that slice in which object is, and you download just that object that contains that slice. You don't download all the objects for the entire 100 gig file. Also has support for the file system in user space, so you can give it a manifest file and you can mount all those files in the file system very fast. You don't actually have the files. You see them in a directory where you mounted. You see them, you can list them, but if you actually want to read from them, that's when it goes and pulls the files. Okay? But you just, if you just want to navigate the structure of the files, okay, you can do it much faster than downloading 100 files, sorting to them just to find out that you maybe don't need all of them. And I would say that the client is very fast. In Collaboratory, it takes about 15 minutes to download the 100 gig file because the Ceph cluster and the OpenStack cluster are in the same physical space connected by 10 gig networking. Download speed is very fast, and that allows you to basically save the time for analysis. For a workflow that takes a week to execute, 15 minutes is not a big not a bit wasted time to basically prepare the data. In the last 2 years, we had almost 22,000 instances. We have more than 80 users. This slide is a little bit old. 34 research labs we have from Australia, from Europe, Israel, US, Canada. We have more than 650 terabytes of protected data sets. So I'm talking whole genomes, mutation calling from the three pipelines that the PCOG pan-cancer whole genome analysis project. There's a pipeline from Broad, one from Sanger, and one from EMBL-DKFZ that analyze the data generated by ICGC. So all this data, which is protected data, is stored in Collaboratory. A PI can open up an account with Collaboratory, enroll its students, and they have access to the OpenStack over the internet. They create virtual machines, they download the data, they do the analysis without having to deploy the infrastructure, download the data sets over the internet to their environments, wait and wait and wait. What we have right now in Collaboratory is almost 2,600 CPUs. We still have money left in the budget to acquire more hardware. The compute nodes have a total of 18 terabytes of RAM. So 285 terabytes of local disk, 7.6 petabytes of object storage, which is separate from the compute local storage, with 10 gigabytes, gigabytes per second networking in between. So it's a very modern hardware. Very fast and efficient. We also developed, the bioinformatics department developed an in-house reporting app. And this allows the PIs who have accounts here to log in and to see usage and cost per day, per user, per type of service. So they can see if a student left the VM running, maybe the student left the lab, or they can, why is this VM that costs like $3 a day with 16 cores and so much RAM for the last 2 weeks? Oh, I forgot about it. Okay, so it's a daily update showing usage. Do you have any questions so far? Because I'm going pretty fast. I have a lot of slides. No questions? Okay. Yes.
So this is a really naive question. I haven't done a lot of cloud-based
I'm not familiar with Compute Canada. It's probably an HPC cluster. It's totally different. In an HPC cluster, you use your SSH into a head node, and you have a job scheduler. You push a job into the queue, and it gets pulled by all the workers and executed, and you have a shared file system usually. And you don't have root access. You cannot change the libraries. You cannot. In OpenStack, you provision your VMs. You don't have a job scheduler. You are the job scheduler. You can build a job scheduler, but it's not there automatically. OpenStack has its own scheduler, but that is used by the cloud to decide where your VMs will be running. So it knows the capacity available in the cloud. So if you want a VM with 24 cores, it finds a server that has 24 cores available, so tells that node, hey, start this virtual machine. So that's the internal OpenStack scheduler. If you want to send a script and just to be executed, unfortunately, OpenStack and Cloud and Amazon, they don't do that for you. Sure, you can start 20 virtual machines, you can install SunGrid Engine, and you have a job scheduler, and you have a master node and 19 worker nodes, and you can send your script to that queue, okay? But it's a layer on top of the infrastructure managed by OpenStack. It's basically you have to deploy your own HPC cluster on top of virtual machines. And you have users who have done that. It's not very efficient, unfortunately, because, again, you have single points of failure. If the VM where your master node is running has a problem, your entire HPC cluster is virtualized, is going to be impacted. If all the 19 servers are reading from just that one VM, you have, again, a bottleneck. It's not very scalable. Maybe it works for a cluster with 20 nodes. Does it work for a cluster with 50 nodes? Probably not. So the more you scale it out, the more slower it becomes and vulnerable to single failures. So Docker is an open source project that automates the deployment of Linux applications inside software containers. It wraps all the libraries, the operating system, so you can have a Docker container that's based on the Ubuntu, and you run it on top of Red Hat operating system. You can run it on top of Windows even. So it's totally containerized application with libraries with everything it needs to run, and it's one package. And you can pull the Docker container and run it, and it runs the same on different servers. And it guarantees basically that the software will run the same. And it's very useful for developers because in the past, there was a problem with, I developed this software, works on my computer, why when you deploy it in production, it's not working. Okay. If you give the IT team that does the provisioning a Docker container and you say it's working, it's going to work in production as well. It's totally containerized. Yes?
Does it mean, like, so for a software with all those dependencies, like each different, say, Python version,
yeah,
all those are all
computer? They are all in there.
And I don't need to do anything.
Yes. Yes. That's one of the biggest selling points of Docker, and everybody is moving towards Docker instead of having Debian packages or RPMs or tarballs. Okay, you get into conflicts with other dependencies on the system. You start with Ubuntu, and then you go inside the container and you install what you need, and then create a container, and it's very easy to trace the file system layers, the changes that happen. So you can have multiple versions of containers. One container that diverged from this version to the other version just because you upgraded one package inside. Docker is actually a company that made popular the container technology. It's not a new technology. It was used by developed by IBM 40 years ago, but they came up with easy-to-use APIs and toolsets for which makes it very popular right now. And there are other container technologies other than Docker, but so far they seem to be the leading solution. And there is no cost to use it. They make money providing other solutions like enterprise versions, but just for the open source version works very well for everybody. Some of the benefits, first of all, containers are much smaller than full VMs. So if a full VM has hundreds of megabytes, gigabytes, Docker container can be very small. It runs faster, so the startup time for a container is seconds. For a virtual machine, the virtual machine still has to boot, so it has to detect the hardware, even if it's virtualized hardware, virtualized CPU and disk and memory, it still has to detect them to go to the boot process. Docker container doesn't have to do that. It runs on top of the kernel of the operating system where the Docker executes. So it's much faster startup. It runs closer to bare metal because it's one layer less of overhead from the operating system. If you run Docker containers on bare metal, so you have a server, you install Ubuntu, and then run Docker containers, you'll get better performance than if you had a physical server running Ubuntu and you install a VM running Ubuntu. Okay. But the drawbacks is that because the Docker containers run as root, if the application or the user who controls the Docker container escapes the jail, it's easier to attack the host as well as other Docker containers. Okay, so the security for Docker containers is not very good so far, okay? And that's why you cannot run Docker containers in HPC environments because the IT admin doesn't want to have user A running containers and potentially impacting user B or somebody else or even the host itself, the server that is managed by IT. What usually Docker users do, they start virtual machines, and they run Docker containers, and they have their Docker containers running the same VM. So if something happens, it's their kids that attack each other. So you don't share a server or a virtual machine running Docker containers from multiple users. You still get the benefits of containerization, portability, and everything else without or minimizing the risk of running containers with untrusted users. This is a picture I'm showing the difference between. So in a physical server, we have the black layer, which is the hardware itself, with the CPU, memory, everything else. You have the operating system, and then you have a hypervisor, which is usually KVM in open source. Then you have virtual machines, and they also have their own operating system, could be different than the host itself. And they also have binaries and libraries, and then on top of that, they have the application. So a lot of overhead. In containers, you have, of course, you have to start with the physical layer. You can abstract that. And you have the operating system, could be Ubuntu or Red Hat. And then on top of that, you have directly the container, which has binaries and libraries that are different of those on the host. Okay? And as you can, and you have the application. So the overhead is much smaller, and it's faster to boot, and it takes less space. The only problem is security. Those applications, those containers, unless they are all your containers and you trust them, it's not good to run containers with other people on the same host. Okay. So I split the lecture into two parts, part one and part two. I wasn't sure how fast I'll go to part one. Do you think I went too fast? You have questions? Can we continue part two? Good? Okay. So I'll talk a little bit about the ICGC data sets, how you search on the collaboratory, on the portal for collaborative data, how to access it, then how you customize a virtual machine with your software and you snapshot it, basically freeze those changes into a virtual machine that you can use it to later start more virtual machines pre-configured with your changes already. And then we'll go through a scale-out planning exercise, which is going to be pretty interesting if we get there. So ICGC, not sure if most of you know what ICGC is. It's a consortium started about 8 years ago. Actually, 10 years ago, in 2008. So it's a 10-year project. The goal was to collect 500 tumors and match normal DNA samples for 50 most common types of cancer. So 25,000 donors and 50,000 genomes. Each of the 50 projects cost $20 million to fund. There are about 17 countries who committed funds. And for each type of cancer, they wanted to have at least two countries or two projects covering that type of cancer. Because mutations in cancer types are different, they wanted to see if liver cancer from Germany is similar to liver cancer in US, for example. And skin cancer in Australia is different than skin cancer covered by the Japan. And also they wanted to see if once they put all this data together, what are the common mutations between types of cancer. Maybe brain cancer in UK has mutations that show up on breast cancer in Korea. So the more data they have, the easier it is to solve this gigantic puzzle that's cancer. From all these 25,000 genomes, took 10 years for data to be collected and analyzed. 2,834 donors had whole genome sampled. That means that much more data was generated for this data sample and the data set. And after it was sequenced, the genomes were aligned using the same algorithm against the same reference genome. Because initially, each lab align it with their own libraries and against different genome, and the results were not uniform, so you couldn't compare and or draw conclusions based on different. So they took all the data and they realigned it with just one algorithm, BWMM. They froze the version that they used, and they used the same reference genome. After that, three research groups, the Broad Institute, DKF that partnered with EMBL, and Sanger Institute in UK, developed their own workflows. And they took 63 whole genomes from this list, and they sent them to the wet lab, and they found the mutations manually. And then they compared with what the three algorithms found. And they basically, the goal is to find and to develop a gold standard in mutation calling that is as accurate as possible, as fast as possible, and as economic as possible in terms of resources that is needed. So of the three algorithms, of course, one is better in part of the mutation calling, another one is faster. So the goal in the end is, after the papers are published, to maybe merge part of the algorithms and to make this gold mutation caller, or to decide which one of them is recommended to use going forward. A typical workflow was you take the tumor sequence, you align it, and then you run different callers. And then you do the same for the normal. So after mutation, after alignment, basically the two samples where we had patients who had multiple cancer, and we had two more samples for more than one.
Can I ask something?
Yes.
After this benchmarking with samples, you know, for example, which was the combination? So because for alignment, you said that they used the but then downstream for the variant calling, what was used? And then for the variants, like
the in the lab, you mean?
No, by much. I mean as an algorithm.
Yeah, so they use these three workflows.
But they used all of them?
Yeah.
So then why did they do the benchmark? Why did they do the lab thing? To validate?
So the labs. The results from the lab was considered to be the gold, okay? That's the correct one. And then let's look at the bioinformatics workflows. What did they find? Which one is more accurate?
Yeah.
You cannot do the wet lab for very large data sets because it was cost a lot and very time consuming, but they selected these 63 tumors that have very good coverage. And they said, okay, we'll do it in the lab to find exactly where the mutations are.
Right, but apparently one, let's say, of the three algorithms picks mutations that the other one doesn't pick, right?
Yeah, but
so
there are...
So there is also reported that are like the intercept, the union, what is
it? I don't know exactly what they will decide in the end. There are working groups in ICGC that are focusing on different parts of the analysis, and... there are papers that are going to be published hopefully soon, and we'll see when they come out with what the conclusion is. Some workflow might be better at detecting indels, another one might be better at detecting SNVs, I don't know. But the idea was that to have something that the wet lab confirms exists, and to see if which workflow is better at confirming those results and how many resources the workflow used. Like if you have a workflow that is very correct but takes 3 months to run, okay, is it feasible, or you want to have a workflow that takes a week to run? Is it good for clinic? The 3 months one, the patient might be dead by then, so you cannot wait. So sometimes maybe 85% accuracy, but a shorter time is better than 92% accuracy and 3 months. So
sorry,
Yes.
They're comparing, so supposing they want to look for SMBs or Intel, they're comparing different tools, you mean, to see which one gives better, like more accurate results, or entire workflow, as you're saying?
So the workflow is...
What do you mean by saying workflow? Is it just, you know, a general... the general steps or the actual tools?
Yeah, so it's the general steps, but also the tools. So in the workflow, there are well-known steps, okay, that use tools like binaries that exist already, but also there are steps that they developed for this purpose. Like you have the first step where you download the data, then you do sorting, and then you do this and that, okay, and step five, you run this binary that does something. That binary doesn't exist or didn't exist before. It's not published. It's not open sourced. Broad created that. Okay? And DKFZ did the same for a few steps in the workflow. Okay? Also, if you change the order, you do splitting and then merging and then okay sorting, you might get a different result. Okay? Maybe it runs faster. Maybe it's more efficient. Maybe the end result is different. If you have a 63 results that you can compare with, you see, okay, if we do it differently, we get to a correct result, but we do it faster, and less memory requirements or less CPU. So it's very important when you plan to do this at scale to fine-tune the algorithms and the order and everything else. So it's like a contest. The best product, the best tool wins. So the BWA, for example, was taking 5 days times two because you have two specimens, two more on normal, and you needed about 240 gigabytes per donor. Okay, so 120 times two. And this is with a VM that had 8 cores, 16 gigs of RAM. And again, we did this across 2,400 samples, 2,400 donors in 14 cloud environments. And we had VMs with different structures, like some of them had more memory per CPU, some of them have less, more disk, less disk. We basically used the compute capacity that was made available by different organizations that were part of ICGC. So DKFZ donated from their cluster so many cores, and ETRI did the same, and we had the HPC cluster in Barcelona, and we had a budget for Amazon. So we had to adapt to what we had available to work with. And we had to do data management, job management, quality control. It was probably a year of work to do end-to-end. Again, this is a slide from the Peacock. So we had access to 14 academic and commercial clouds with dedicated cloud admins. Use the metadata server that was keeping track of the progress and of the samples that were analyzed. We were downloading the data from multiple data repositories around the world. So they had a few genome sites that were called with software that allowed sequencing centers to upload the files. And then maybe we had the data in genome site in EBI in London, but we didn't have any compute capacity available in London, but we had compute available in DKFZ. So we start VMs in DKFZ, and they would download the data over the internet from EBI in London, analyze it, and then upload the aligned sequences to DKFZ. And then we had to synchronize the repositories, DKFZ back to London. As you can imagine, we are talking about 800 terabytes of data, 14 cloud environments, international project, US, Canada, Germany, everybody was pitching in. This geographic distribution of the Pico compute resources. So as you can see, the C sites are compute centers. The G ones are the genomes repositories where the data was stored. Okay? And S, where we had the S3 compatible data storage. So, and again, sometimes we had the compute and the genomes repository in the same place. Okay, so you can download pretty fast, because if you have genomes in EBI and you have compute in EBI, it's pretty fast to download. But sometimes the compute in EBI is already running 100%, and you have data available in DKF network. You have to move data around. Not very efficient. And that's why when everything was done, we uploaded all the data in Collaboratory, so we have compute and storage in the same place. So we don't have to, if we have to do something like that, we have a place where we can do it much, much faster. The data that is stored, as I said, it Collaboratory, AWS, and Genos site, but Genos are retired now, is indexed in the portal. We also partner for Collaboratory with University of Chicago. So the ICGC, basically a subset of the ICGC called the TCGA data, the US data, cannot leave the US soil. So we couldn't store it at Collaboratory, but it is stored at the University of Chicago. It's a protected data set, but if you are a researcher who is DACO approved to access these data sets, you can download them and use them, okay? But you cannot, as a research organization that makes the data available further, you cannot store it outside of US soil. But OICR and the Collaboratory has a very fast connection to Chicago. So if a researcher who is running compute at in Collaboratory can download data sets from TCGA stored in Chicago over this very fast network connection, faster than the regular internet, because Toronto and Chicago have fiber optic dedicated for research. How you can search the data sets in ICGC? You can do it by sample UID, by type of disease, by project, type of data. There are so many ways you can filter and search for data that you are interested in. At the end, after you search and selected the data that you want to look at, you can either download the manifest file, or if it's just a single file, copy its object UID, and then you can use it with the download client to download the data. The custom client, as I said, can allows you to request just a slice of the whole genome. You can mount the single BAM or multiple BAMs into directory. You can resume interrupted downloads. So it has a lot of features that are designed to help you work with large data sets. You don't want to restart a download that is midway through and having to re-download 300 gigabytes. And for a large download, even if it's fast, still it's going to be minutes or hours. So the chances for interruptions to happen are quite high. So that's why you need a client that can deal with this kind of interruptions. Protected data stored in a Collaboratory is... So the ICGC data set basically stored in Collaboratory and Amazon. In Amazon, Amazon has just a subset of Collaboratory data. There are some projects that didn't allow data to be stored in a commercial cloud like Amazon. So we couldn't store them in there, but they allowed us to store the data in Canada in a research cloud environment that's open only to cancer researchers. So we don't accept users to create accounts in Collaboratory if they are not DACO approved. The workflow to access the data is the same in Collaboratory or Amazon. You start a virtual machine, you install this ICGC storage client, this custom client that we developed, and then you go to the DCC portal, you log in, you have a login button. If you have a DACO approved account, you log in and then you can generate a token. The token is good for Amazon or Collaboratory. You go back to your virtual machine where you install the client, you put that token in your configuration file, and then you tell your client to download this file or this list of files. The way it works, the virtual machine, the client, talks to the S3 API, gives it the token, actually talks to the authentication server, gives it the token, the authentication server verifies that the token is valid, okay? It finds the S3 API object that matches the UID that you gave it and generates temporary URLs. And the client after that talks to the S3 API and downloads the files directly. So it's not in the data path. It's in the data path just at the beginning when it validates the token and asks for the temporary URLs. The temporary URLs are good only for 24 hours. So even if you forward those to somebody who's not DACO approved, the access to the files is limited to 24 hours. And this way, we don't give access to the entire bucket where all the files are. We give access just to the files that that token should give access. Okay. So it allows more granular access and more temporary limited access than if we just keep them in S3 and you give access to somebody, give access to the entire bucket. Yes.
So in order to download the data, mm-hmm. right, from there, you have to use a virtual machine. Is it necessary? Or you could, in theory, because this is not true, if you had a cluster, mm-hmm. right, that is all encrypted and everything, and you can download even basic data, then could you just do it by installing the client that you have there, or do you have to use a virtual machine?
So, if I get this right, I'll tell you how it works, and maybe this answers your question. First of all, Amazon stores the data for free with the condition that is accessible only from EC2 instances running in the region where it is stored. Okay. So it's a win-win situation because we get to have this data stored for free. We don't have to pay Amazon a lot of money to store it, and Amazon receives the payment for the EC2 usage by the researchers who need access to the data. Okay, so you cannot download the data from Amazon directly to your lab. The same with Collaboratory. You go to Collaboratory, start virtual machines. Okay, you download the data on those virtual machines. You don't download directly outside of Collaboratory. With the client, if you don't want to use the client, you can tell the client just to generate the temporary URLs. And it has a flag, give me temporary URLs, and you get back a list of temporary URLs, very long URLs. You can do wget or curl or any other tool you want to download it. Okay? The difference is that if you do it like that, you are going to do usually serialized wgets. So instead of having a VM that has 8 cores and the ICGC client, if you tell it to use 7 cores, it's going to start 7 parallel downloads. And it's going to get parts of the large file in the same time, and then it's going to put them together. And if it breaks halfway, it knows how to continue from there. If you do it wget, it's not that efficient. Yes, you can do it. Maybe you have other tools. So in the end, if you look when the download happens, there is a directory that has a long list of temporary URLs. And the client basically look in that list, takes 7 at a time, starts when it finishes them, takes another 7 if you tell it to use 7 processes. You can access in Collaboratory non-protected data, so maybe you have your own data sets, okay, that are not stored in Collaboratory, data that you generated. You can upload the data and use it. You have space to upload it, and you have compute to analyze it. You don't have to wait for how long it takes for your IT department to provision the resources needed for your analysis. And you have access to very large protected data sets already stored in Collaboratory, very fast accessible. Some of the recommendations we make to our users when they are working in Collaboratory or Amazon or any other cloud environment are to use snapshots to freeze and reuse a good working version of your virtual machine. This is not that important anymore with Docker containers, because the container has everything, but usually you start with a base image, which is a Ubuntu image, and maybe you want to install Docker before you can use it. So install Docker, maybe you make other changes, and then you take a snapshot. Okay? Next time when you start your work, you start 20 virtual machines, they already have Docker installed on your changes. You just SSH, pull your containers, your application, your workflow, pull your data, and start the execution. Because at scale, failure is a given. You cannot avoid it. And that's why Amazon has multiple regions, and they tell you to scale horizontally your application. Because if you have a failure, and failure is going to happen, probably never happened to you virtual machine failure in Amazon, because they have so many, so the chances to happen to you. But it happens to people who have enough VMs. It happened to us. I had VMs crash in Amazon, and you lose everything, basically, if you didn't scale your application to deal with a failure. So you have to treat your workloads as ephemeral. Use automation, configuration management to have a consistent application. You don't want to have each workflow a little bit different than the other one. Use good monitoring tools to know what your VMs are doing. Are they stuck at a step and you don't know, and 2 weeks later you find out that it's stuck there and you wasted 22 weeks of work waiting for it to complete? If you had a monitoring solution that has a graph of CPU usage, you'll see it's flat at 0% or 1%, then it's doing nothing. So you SSH. When you have one, it's easy to do it daily, but if you have 100, you need something that's like a monitoring solution that installs the monitoring agent when the VM starts. So next time, you don't have to do the work again. You have it already installed. And there are some tools, like Sensu is one of them. That's a new type of monitoring solution where the servers connect back to a monitoring server and they auto-register, so you don't have to go to each of them to configure them. As they come up, they call back home and they pre-register. So you want as hands-free solution as possible. I'm going to cover a little bit about the snapshot, because it might be a new term for you. Is snapshotting is freezing the hard disk of a virtual machine with all the changes. Okay, like you take an image, it stays like that. When you take the snapshot, it is uploaded to the image repository in the cloud. So next time when you start a virtual machine, if you choose the snapshot to be the base image for your virtual machine, you'll get the same virtual machine as when you took the snapshot. Okay? So you take the time, you start with a plain, let's say, Ubuntu virtual machine, you install your application, install Docker, you install some repositories, you install some certificates, you do whatever you have to do. And then when you are happy with that virtual machine, you take the snapshot. That basically becomes your new gold image. Tomorrow, if you want to have 30 VMs like that, you start 30 based on that one, and you have 30 exactly the same, like twins. There are some considerations when taking a snapshot. So you have to clean up confidential data. because if you have in that virtual machine some private keys, some tokens, some credentials, when you take the snapshot, that base image is available to anybody in your project. It's not public, okay, but it's available to any other users of the project that you are part of. Okay, so John and Mary, they are two students, and John creates a snapshot but forgets his credentials in there. Mary starts an instance from the snapshot. She has access to John's credentials. Maybe you want to share this snapshot with Joe. Joe is part of another project. Okay, you want to, him to take your snapshot with your application, to give it a try, to validate it, to work on it. So you clean it up before taking the snapshot of any confidential data that shouldn't be part of the snapshot. Also, very important, so how you do that, you basically remove the authorized keys. Oh, that's important because if you don't remove this file, then you can SSH, theoretically, in all the virtual machines started from that snapshot. Okay, it's like you give somebody, you sell your house, but you keep a set of keys. Okay, so when they start VMs from that snapshot, their key is going to be appended to this file, but your key is still there. If the security groups, the firewall allows you to SSH, you'll be able to SSH. So it's polite, basically, not keep your keys in the image. But also it means that once you delete this file, you cannot SSH back. So you do this the last step before taking the snapshot. Once you delete this file and you took the snapshot, if you want to SSH again, you won't be able. You are locked out. You sold your house. Keep the image size small. What happens is basically the virtual machine starts from a base image which is small. You install your application which grows the image, okay, the VM disk, and then maybe you download 50 gigs of reference data, okay? You run a test analysis, you are happy with the result. You delete the 50 gigs of data, okay? And then you take a snapshot, and it takes forever. Why? It was a small image. No, it's the disk on the hypervisor, on the server where this VM is running. When you put 50 gigs of data, it ballooned, okay? When you delete the data, the operating system doesn't know that you deleted the data inside the VM, okay? So when you take the snapshot, your file that has to be uploaded to the image repository is gonna have 50 gigs of empty space, but it's still 50 gigs that next time when you start an image or 50 images of that from that base image, it's gonna take longer because you have to wait for 50 gigs to be downloaded. And you have to pay for storing an image, a snapshot, which is 50 gigs. Okay? So what you do, you start an image, install your software, you download your reference data, you run analysis, you are happy, you start a second instance, you do just the application without reference data, okay? And that's the one you snapshot. You don't snapshot an instance that you inflated and then deflated, because now you know what happens in the back end. Yes?
Wouldn't that be error-prone? What if you forget to do, like, replicate the steps, like, exactly? Like, if you do something else, then, you know?
Yes, if it's the user has to basically, I do these steps and it works, I just have to do it again without downloading the data.
And when you say you have to do it again,
yeah,
like you have to re-download every packet you have done, and you could, in theory, give a snapshot for the instance just before you download it.
You can take the snapshot before you download, but without running those applications on the downloaded data, you might not be sure that they work as you think it works.
I mean,
okay.
If
you run history in Bash, it's going to tell you all the comments you run in there. So you can easily just see what you did and run them again on a new instance.
So why doesn't it realize when you delete something? Why doesn't it shrink back?
Because the operating system where the virtual machine runs doesn't see inside the instance. Okay, so the disk of the instance of the virtual machine is just a file on the file system of the hypervisor. And that file, as you make changes, grows. Okay, when you delete files inside, it doesn't shrink. That's one of the things to keep in mind if you work in Collaboratory or another OpenStack, Amazon. It takes time to take a snapshot. Again, if the instance is large, a snapshotting because it shuts it down, takes a snapshot, and then has to upload this very large file to the image repository. So the bigger snapshot is, the longer it takes not only to take the snapshot, but also later when you provision new virtual machines based on that snapshot. Mistakes can be costly. If you have a bug in your provisioning process and you start 10 instances and you are charged by the hour, okay, and you shut it down 10 minutes later, you are going to pay for 10 hours, okay, because that's not as valid anymore because Amazon used to charge by the hour. Now they are charging by the minute, I believe. Okay. So, but before, when people had CI/CD pipelines, which is continuous integration, continuous delivery, then they start a fleet of servers and shut them down and do it again. You can do this many times in an hour and you pay many hours. If you do 10 instances every 10 minutes, in an hour, you have 60 hours of usage. Now with Amazon charging by the minute, and Google also reduced their charging intervals. In Collaboratory, the way we charge is by the minute. Actually, it's not by the minute. We add the time. We only round up the last hour. So if you have a VM that runs for 30 minutes, and a VM that runs for 20 minutes, and one that runs for 10 minutes, and then one that runs for 5 minutes, okay, you'll have 65 minutes. You'll pay for 2 hours. But you don't round up every time. You round up only the total to 1 hour. As I said, you have to clean up the confidential data. You have to plan your image. If you have, if the workflow needs a reference data set, it's better to have it available on a web server in the same environment. So maybe you provision a VM with a web server, you upload your reference data, and then you start 30 VMs, virtual machines that need that reference data, and they download it from the local web server. It's much faster than having each of them the reference data, and much cheaper. Also, it's good to update the security, to run all the security updates when the virtual machine starts, because the operating system could be not up to date, and security updates are available almost daily. So the good practice, start after SSH, first step, update all the packages. I think I have time for the scale-out planning exercise. So basically, let's say that you have to, you created a workflow that performs mutation calling and you want to run it on 100 samples. Based on your previous tests, it takes on a VM with 2 cores and 16 gigs of RAM about 24 hours to complete the workflow. And you have an account with a cloud provider or Collaboratory or somewhere else where you have a budget for 100 cores for 72 hours continuously. Okay, let's say like being Collaboratory, $200. But you also have a CPU quota, which means that you cannot just get 1,000 cores for half a day and be done. They give you a maximum of 100 cores. Okay, so you have to basically organize your workflow and your data to fit in this time budget equation. And then your data samples, you have 100 samples, but 85 of them are around 180 gigs, but 15 of them are much larger, 310. And your cloud provider or wherever you run it has a number of predefined hardware templates to choose from. Okay, so the cloud is flexible, but it's not, I want half a core and 7 gigs of RAM, or I want 3 cores and 15. You cannot just make your own, because they have physical servers that have a set number of cores in memory, so they split it into equal chunks, okay? So they can basically, like a puzzle, like a Lego, make it use the entire, okay? So if somebody uses like 3 cores and 100 gigs of RAM, then they have a lot of cores available, but no memory on that server, not good. So they have predefined templates, and the same in Collaboratory. You have 1 core, 8 gigs of RAM, so on. So these are your predefined hardware options. So how do you organize your VMs to fit in the in this budget? So you can have a VM or have a Python-based web server that you load your 100 UIDs, 100 files, just the UIDs, okay? And the web server accepts requests on different paths. Small sample and large sample, done and done. When the VM starts, they do a POST request to this address, just POST, okay, in HTTP. What they get back is a UID of a sample. The web server marks that UID as being in progress, because now it knows that this VM is working on that sample. The VM takes the UID, downloads the data, runs the analysis, does everything it has to do. At the end of the workflow, the VM, the last step, does a POST request against the same server saying, hey, I'm done. So the server moves that UID from in progress to finished. So you as a bioinformatician can just monitor this web server and see how many samples are in progress, when did they go in progress, are they staying there for too long, so there is a problem with that VM that is working on that sample. So in day one, you start 49 VMs with 2 cores, C1 small flavor. You use maybe Ansible, which is a tool for configuration management. Start the VM, the VMs go, they do a POST request, they get the samples, they run the analysis. At the end of day one, you basically use 49 times 2, use 98 cores of your 100 cores quota, and you completed 49 of the small samples. Okay? Second day, you do 34 VMs, and use 68 cores, but you also start 4 C1 jumbo, because this type of flavor has enough space to accommodate the large samples. Also have more cores. At the end of day two, you have 83 average samples and 4 large ones. Day three, you do the same. A few VMs of small flavor and a few jumbo ones. At the end of the day three, you still have a little bit of budget, so you used 88 cores of day three. So if you had any VMs that failed day one or day two, you can rerun them. What this tells us is it's important to pick the right flavor for the job. Do not just start one type of flavor for every type of job. Look at the data sample. If the data sample is small, start a small VM. If the data sample is large, start a large one. Just don't use the same size for everything. That's going to save you a lot of money, especially for large scale. If we are talking about 1, 2, 3, maybe it doesn't make a difference. But cancer research in the future is going to be about numbers. More and more analysis, very computational intensive. You cannot draw a conclusion if you just find it once. You have to find it many times to confirm it's not a coincidence. So it has to be large-scale analysis. Monitor the progress of your analysis and be ready to run stuck or failed workflows. You can't just start the work and do something else and then come back and find out that half of them died because you had a problem with your web server or because you have to keep an eye on the workflows. Start small, so you don't launch 100 VMs from the beginning. Okay, that's why I said, do the test, see how long it takes, confirm everything is working as expected in your workflow, and try to limit external dependencies. So if you download the data from an FTP server in the other part of the world, if that data is needed in step three of the workflow, how about you download the data and put it on a server which is local? So if that server in Germany is down, you are not impacted. Or if the Ubuntu repository has a problem with that package, okay, if you take a snapshot, everything is installed up and working, then you know that you don't have any external dependencies that can break your analysis.